So you're here for the first time, or back for the first time. Good to have you with us. Also welcome those on the Parish Facebook page. Just remember that things are slightly different. Holy Communion at the end of Mass, the stewards will assist us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So our Mass is offered for the good estate of David and Lisa Young. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous thought. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary of Conversion, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever. Amen.
Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It's none too much. The man who gathered little did not go short. The word of the Lord.
When Jesus had crossed in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed by the lakeside. Then one of the synagogue officials came up, Jairus by name, and seeing him, fell at his feet and pleaded with him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is desperately sick. Do come and lay your hands on her to make her better and save her life." Jesus went with him, and the large crowd followed him. They were pressing all around him. Now there was a woman who had suffered from a hemorrhage for 12 years. After long and painful treatment under various doctors, she had spent all she had without being any the better for it. In fact, she was getting worse. She had heard about Jesus and she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his cloak. "If I can touch even his clothes," she had told herself, "I shall be well again." And the source of the bleeding dried up instantly, and she felt in herself that she was cured of her complaint. Immediately aware that power had gone out from him, Jesus turned round in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" His disciples said to him, "You see how the crowd is pressing round you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" But he continued to look all around to see who had done it. Then the woman came forward, frightened and trembling, because she knew what had happened to her, and she fell at his feet and told him the whole truth. "My daughter," he said, "your faith has restored you to health. Go in peace and be free from your complaint." While he was still speaking, some people arrived from the house of the synagogue official to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why put the master to any further trouble?" But Jesus had overheard this remark of theirs, and he said to the official, "Do not be afraid, only have faith." And he allowed no one to go with him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. So they came to the official's house, and Jesus noticed all the commotion, the people weeping and wailing unrestrainedly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and crying? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. So he turned them all out, and taking with him the child's father and mother and his own companions, he went into the place where the child lay. And taking the little child by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I tell you to get up." The little girl got up at once and began to walk about, for she was 12 years old. At this they were overcome with astonishment. And he ordered them strictly not to let anyone know about it, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Very good. So why is death then, even after a ripe old age, still hard for us to process and move beyond? In the death of a loved one, we speak of loss. That's a very appropriate word, as a presence once so keenly felt is now missing. It can be such an intense feeling, even perhaps alien to our existence. So intense, it comes like a thief in the night. And of course, our reflection is that death has entered our world because of sin and the disobedience to God and his gifts. As a person is a unity of body and soul, our physical death is not the final word. And so we say at death, life is changed and not ended. And when this earthly temple of our body turns to dust, a new and eternal dwelling is made ready for our souls in heaven. Our Lord alludes to this when he says, the girl is only sleeping. Yes, the body has died and cannot be woken by any earthly command, but her soul is living on. And the one who called her into life in the first instance, as an affirmation of his divinity, chooses to reawaken her in the here and now. He'll do that for us on the resurrection of the body on the last day. But he even does it now for our souls, which are dead, in the sacrament of reconciliation. He awakens us to new life, that life of grace first given to us at holy baptism. Because, as we know also from the scriptures, God is of the living. And in this we take our comfort and our hope in knowing that all the ties of friendship and affection that knit us together as one throughout our lives, that doesn't unravel with death. And thus we continue to pray for our loved ones to complete their final purifications so that they may take their place among the communion of saints. Our true home is in heaven, and Jesus Christ, whose return we long for, will come from heaven to save us. We don't place our hope in material things, those that wither and fade. There are no pockets in a shroud, it is said. And so we put our faith in the person of Jesus Christ for our salvation. We demonstrate that by storing up for ourselves those things that endure. Faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. But we're not speaking of some superficial feeling or emotion. We're speaking of agape. That love with which we can lay down our life for the sake of the gospel and the redemption of souls. This is the love of the cross. This is my body, which is given up for you. But the devil's there in the background, whispering a contrary voice, proposing instead, this is my body, which is for me. St. Paul then appeals for generosity. Now in his context, he's asking for funds to support the faithful in Jerusalem. Perhaps in Bexhill, our appeal is a bit more mundane. We need people to support the maintenance and mission of the parish. And that's both financially and importantly, more importantly perhaps, in service. In service of the liturgy, in service of formation, and in service of outreach. And much of that's going to need to be rebuilt, almost from scratch, once the COVID restrictions are finally lifted. And that's going to be true from parish to parish across the country. Jesus Christ is our example of detachment and generosity. Although he was God, he did not cling to his equality with the Father. He empties himself. He becomes like a slave to redeem us. that he raises us up to the dignity of becoming children of God, so that we may claim the inheritance of eternal life with the Blessed Trinity in heaven. And our generosity must also extend beyond these walls to announce the gospel of the Lord, especially to those on the periphery of our parish who need to hear the good news of salvation. And like the woman with the hemorrhage, many people need spiritual healing because their life may be devoid of meaning, well, certainly beyond that of which society says is important. Remember that Jesus Christ remains our deepest desire. He is the one who came to give us life in abundance, including those with a questionable life history. For in the church, every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. And so we should never shy away of preaching the metanoia. That's Christ's call to conversion and repentance. You have a very busy Sunday ahead of you. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day. You are indeed holy.